Thank you, Veena ji. I'd like to thank Dr. Garg for giving me this opportunity and coming and addressing the youth and the future of India. It's a pleasure to participate in this Congress. And as Veena ji mentioned, it's really credible to ensure that such conferences carry on year after year. And the ninth year significantly marks the breakthrough point when we'll celebrate the 10th anniversary of the Congress next year. My congratulations to you, Dr. Garg. I'd like to make my presentations mostly interactive, so I'll want the participants and the audience to ask queries. I'll be putting some thoughts forward. I'd like you to respond to that, and that's what makes it so interesting. Veena ji has already covered the section that focuses on what the industry is supposed to do, but then any kind of talent development, HR development, skill development has a handshake point. On one end, there are facilitators. You have organizations want to do the skill development and talent development, but it cannot happen without the participation of the people. People need to change. Unless that happens, no kind of skill development program, no kind of talent development program will work. All of us are aware that Industry 4.0 has arrived, right? So anybody, what is Industry 4.0? Can somebody help me out? We had Industry 1.0, 2.0, 3.0, and we are at 4.0 now. Anybody who knows how the evolution happened? Okay, so Industry 1.0 was predominantly moving from manual power to steam power. 2.0 was to electrical power. 3.0 was automation. And 4.0 is where you have the artificial intelligence and machines starting to do the entire work. So all of us work with computers, right? You can't imagine a scenario where you are in an environment and you don't have to work with a computer. Imagine you are doing something and your computer breaks down for about a week. World comes to a stop. So the core of the computer is the CPU, right? So out of 100 CPUs manufactured, what number of CPUs go into computers and what number of CPUs go into other equipments? Any idea? 100% going into computers, 50% going into computers. What percentage would go into computers and rest to the other equipments? Take a guess. 60%? Okay, good. The answer is 2%. Out of every 100 CPUs manufactured, 2 CPUs go into a computer. 98 CPUs are going into equipments. You have automobiles, you have washing machines, you have microwaves, you have mixer grinders, you have shavers. Everything that you're using is a CPU. Your phone has a CPU. So what does it mean? No longer knowing about computers is good enough for you. The future generation has to start learning machine learning. It's going to become an integral part of your life. It's like 30 years back, if somebody would have said that computers is only for the geeks. Technology-driven trades, people who are technocrats, people who are research scientists, they require computers. Common man doesn't require computers. You know, it's not right today. Computers are integral to our life. Similarly, the machines that are going to serve us are going to be integral to us. And unless we start getting into machine learning and understanding machine learning, future will not be, you'll not be able to handle the changes that are going to come in the future. Do you know what you'll be doing 10 years down the line? Yeah, you'll be in leadership position. Everybody wants to be in a leadership position, good. But what will you be doing? HR is supposed to be one of the most consistent functions over the decades. What do you see HR today would continue to be like that 10 years down the line? Why not? Okay, we'll discuss that. So I'll start with my discussion. The global economy has witnessed a true transformation in the last few years. We have seen political impactors like Brexit, the US-China trade war. These are the factors which are impacting the global economy. But the largest impactor of global economy in the last few years has been technology evolution. The pace with which technology is changing. There was a time when people are talking about diesel and petroleum-powered vehicles. Gone are the days. People are talking about electric vehicles, hybrid vehicles. We are training petrol pump attendants now. 10 years down the line, you may not have petrol pump attendants. You'll have electrical vehicle attendants. I was talking to somebody in the Gale. So they had a brilliant product. The CNG auto started coming into the country. So the CNG auto drivers were asked, how does the vehicle perform? How does it work? You change from your regular fuel to CNG. So it worked very well for the first 2 years. And then it starts giving us problem. The reason? For the first 2 years, the vehicle was serviced and maintained by the service station because it was under the warranty period. Post that, they started going to technicians outside who had no skill, no knowledge, since they were not trained on the technology, and the vehicle started giving trouble. Same thing is going to happen to the electrical vehicles. How many technicians do we have who can service an electrical vehicle? We are talking about electrical charging points. Do you have technicians who can manage those charging points? So those are the areas that one has to start working on. Be it the pattern of production, consumption, or employment, the speed and scale at which the disruptions we experience and will continue to be experienced will impact our life and will continue to impact our life in a huge way. And the year 2018 could be considered the watershed area or the watershed time where the initial impact of this change was markedly visible. 2018 is the first time that we started talking about AI, started talking about machine learning, because we are seeing that impacting our life. It has been going on for the last 5, 6, 7 years, but the impact has started being visible in the year 2018. There have been periodic warnings that in the last 2 centuries, that automation and new technologies were going to wipe out large number of middle class jobs. So how many of you feel that advent of technology will cause job losses? Good, good. Let me tell you something. Technology has been evolving for the last 5,000 years. People were walking, they started using horses. So palanquin drivers, or the palanquin carriers became obsolete. Chariots started coming into being. The horse carts started coming into being. Bullock-powered plowing started coming into being. And so on and so forth. What has happened? People can still work. 30 years back, we saw the advent of computers coming into the banking system. Suddenly there was a buruhaha. Hey, there'll be a huge number of unemployment happening in the banking sector. As compared to 25, 30 years back, 10 times number of workers are working in the banking sector now. What we need to understand is technology will always change. It is changing, it will continue to change. But it must change. But the fact remains that the human interface with technology 8 hours per day is constant. Only the form of interaction changes. And that's what we need to visualize. Especially for the young kids there. Because what you're doing today is not necessarily what you'll be doing tomorrow. And you need to continuously learn. Gone are the days that I've done my MBA and I'm done. I'm set. I get into a life. The company will look into my technology development, my knowledge development, so on and so forth. No. Companies will do to a certain extent. You have to invest in yourself. If you have to keep yourself relevant in the current context, both in tech terms of technology and processes. It's like doctors. The computer scientists, they keep evolving their skills and knowledge all the time. It has become a factor of life for everybody now. The best known early examples of the technology change impacting society and creating disruption was the Luddite movement in England. In the 19th century, a group of English textile artisans protested the automation of the textile production by seeking to destroy some of the machines. They were manually, it was being done, the handicraft work, and then you had power tools coming in, the power looms coming in, steam driven. And suddenly the handloom workers were kind of driven out of work. Huge protest. Protest is good. But unless you are ready to adapt yourself to the change, the protest will not lead you to the result. Such impacts are incrementally being seen in India, both in terms of technology and requirement to train on the emerging trend, technology. Further, this is very critical, India being a country of 1.3 billion with a median age of 28 puts India at the center of any discussion related to global skills landscape. The ILO study very clearly indicates by the year 2025, there's going to be a huge labor shortage globally. About 55 million labor shortage across the world, including 10 million labor shortage in China alone. India will have a surplus of 46 million working bodies available. So whether we like it or not, the Prime Minister's vision of making India the skill capital of the world will become true. But how skilled is that skill capital? That will decide how much are we able to actually reap the demographic dividend. If you still continue to be doing the bottom of the pyramid skills, it's not going to work. You have to move up the pyramid skills. And people talk about skilling. People think that skill development is only for the school dropouts, the vocational trade. That's not correct. There are a lot of technologies which are requiring high-end skills. There's a machine called a dragline. Some of you would have heard about it, some of you would not have heard about it. It's a huge equipment. You know what is the size of a dragline? The size of the machine? This entire auditorium will fit inside that machine. And that machine walks. The machine has got a boom, which is about 80 meters long, and the end of which it has got a bucket. The bucket is the size of this stage. The scale at which that drag line works, you cannot imagine. One scoop of this bucket can fill up 16 of the trucks that you see working on the road. But it's managed to fill only half the truck which is actually working there. It's called a dumper. It's a 280-ton dumper. So scale has changed. So the operators who are working on those equipment has changed. Initially, the Coal India was looking at taking diploma holders, ITA pass outs. It's changed now. When we went to Sasan project at Reliance, they are hiring M-Tech electrical for doing that job. Wages in mining sector is very, very high. So it's very, very attractive. Though it looks to be a manual work, but it's very high technology job. You're sitting in an air-conditioned cabin, and you're doing the job. But you need to know the technology, you need to be familiar with the technology before you can start using it. On one hand, while this provides with a golden opportunity to reap the demographic dividend, it also puts in the position of responsibility. And like Vinayji said, the responsibility for development of skills is not only governments, the industries will have to start investing in it. Because ultimately it will benefit the industry only. If you look at it, at present about 21% of the jobs are handled by robots. 21% of the jobs today are handled by robots. You go into any of the manufacturing units that you'll see, be it Maruti, be it Honda, be it Samsung cell phone, be it a TV manufacturing unit, you have robotic arms doing various things, including household works. Your washing machine. Today you have robots which are doing the house cleaning job. You program it, plug it into one place, it'll automatically unplug itself, walk around the entire house, clean, go back and plug in itself. By 2022, just about 4 years down the line, 3 years down the line, it is expected to go to 42%, and by about 2025, 68%. Does it mean that human population becomes redundant? No. What we do changes. Even the HR functions are progressively moving onto the platform of AI, like DeepSense and HireVue. Have you heard of these two? I suggest go and have a look at it, Google it up, DeepSense and HireVue. These are the two technologies which are being used by IBM and other companies as a pre-hire tool. It checks out your profile, it checks out what you do, what you have been doing, what you have stated in your resume is correct or not. Only then it calls in you for an interview. So it brings us to the key question, what is a sustainable trade? Or does it mean that every trade will become redundant about 4 years, 5 years down the line? Very selected trades are constant. For example, designing. It can never be done by a machine. The imagination, the visualization, that's the human competence. Trades like plumbing, you can bring in best of technologies to do the work, but the plumbing still requires a plumber's interface. Carpentry. Okay.
So those are the trades. There are some trades will be constant, but there will be trades which are changing. So answer this, very, very little number of trades which are sustainable. You have to continuously, what I'm trying to drive is you have to continuously improve yourself, work on your skills, and think of tomorrow's skills and start planning on them. There was no concept of management program in CSR 5 years down the line. That's become the buzzword today. So it brings us to the question of how do we manage, the core topic is skill development and talent management in petrocoal sector. If you look at the Hayes Global Skill Index in 2018, one of the major challenges that has risen to the surface is the slow growth of wages over a period of time. In some jobs, the wages grow very rapidly, but some jobs, the wages are pretty stagnant, and in some cases, it has in fact gone down. This trend has adversely affected the quality of living of workers. Both these sectors are labor significant sectors, mining particularly. What do you think is the number of people engaged in mining in the country? Any guess? Somebody mentioned 10 million. That's a closer number. Close to about 1 crore people, the entire mining. For every one person directly engaged in the mine, there are about 10 people supporting him in mining related trades only from outside. You have a dumper, which is a 280 ton dumper, brings it from the bench or the face to the dump yard. From there to the loading point is carried by tipper. So a tipper is about 40 ton. So 280 ton dumper is servicing about close to about 7 to 8 tippers. So that's how the trade multiplier happens. Mining has close to about 1 crore people working, directly or indirectly. Large number of smaller mines also are there, and as the scale and the size of the mine decreases, the labor intensity factor increases because it doesn't become productive to have a high technology or a high cost equipment involved there. So we get a greater sense that if you look at about 40% of jobs which will be lost due to technology in the next couple of years, about 5 to 10 years kind of period, these 40% of jobs account for just 7% of the wages. Why? Because people are not evolving their skills, are progressively relegated down the pyramid and the lower wage end of the pyramid, and then they move out into the unemployment segment. Gentlemen who have got gray hair would know that when we used to go to any service station, any equipment service station, a service center, we'll find people with gray hair like us doing equipment repairing and things like that. Just recall in last 12 months or 24 months, if you have gone to any equipment service station and you have found anybody with a gray hair, nobody. The reason is that those people could not change their skills with time with new technology. And therefore, they have been replaced by a younger lot. This is what I'm talking about. What is happening is skills is becoming obsolete and the workers are increasingly relegated to the bottom of the pyramid. Everybody is telling us that the new world jobs are here. What are new world jobs? Any idea? The cognitive learning component that we're talking about is progressively moving into the machines also. Machines are progressively getting programmed to do cognitive jobs. But again, the machines need to be programmed to do their job. And that's where I'm talking about the requirement for every individual to start understanding machine learning. It's going to become an integral part of your life. Well, while the conversation on future of work started in 2016, it remains a concept largely until this year when the actual change in the world of jobs became evident. The job market of India saw the emergence of new age jobs which did not exist a few years back, and this is just the beginning. As per the estimates of various research firms, almost 40 to 50% of existing jobs which are transaction heavy will get automated. Payroll, was hugely a human intensive activity a couple of decades back, totally automated. You no longer have individuals managing payrolls. You'd have computers doing it. Totally automated. HR function that I'm talking about. The pre-assessment of the candidates. Again, getting relegated to AI. The key sectors which would see the change are financial services, manufacturing, transportation, packaging, shipping, etc. And if early trends are to be believed, what is evident is the roles of data entry clerk, cashier, financial analyst, telemarketer, customer service executive, manual worker, operator, executive, factory worker, computer support specialist, retail salesperson, and advertising salesperson are constantly getting disrupted. If Alexa can handle your queries at home, Alexa can handle sales in the shop floor, in the showrooms. Buying is a very, very emotional decision. You justify it through practical means. You don't buy a car because it's got a 1600cc engine, it's got an automated transmission, it has got four wheels with certain specifications. You buy a car because you like a car. Then you justify it to the whole world because it has got all these features, I bought it. When you go to a showroom, and if you have been visiting showrooms, which we used to do earlier, like today, you rarely go to the same showroom again because you move around to a different localities, multiple options available. But earlier when we used to go to showroom, there'll be one Raymond showroom or there'll be one standard showroom that they'll go and purchase. You have a habit of going to the showroom, looking at this and looking up to the same sales executive. There'll be five of them or 10 of them, but repeatedly you'll be interfacing with only one individual. You're not buying the product, you're buying the individual. That's progressively going to go away. As you become dependent on Alexa and such technologies will replace salespeople in the shops, will replace human interface, customer service points in the banks, multiple places. So what I'm talking is not a doomsday scenario. It's not like a Terminator scene where you have all machines taken over and you're fighting against the machine. It will not happen like that. But what I'm trying to say is change is inevitable. Sooner we accept it and sooner we start working on it is better. Automobile industry in its quest of alternate source of energy is hiring and will hire in the coming years for electric motor vehicles. Experts like auto analyst engineers, sustainability integration experts. You would not have heard about these trades a couple of years back. The petrocoal sector cannot remain insular from these emerging changes. But there are significant differences between the two. Where the petroleum sector has rapidly adopted and will require to adopt to the changes, the coal sector is still languishing in the last century. And we're talking about Industry 4.0. I still have equipment which are steam driven in a lot of my mines. Still not moved to Industry 2.0. Leave alone 3.0 and 4.0 is a, that's first factor. Second is the union related issues. I can't have 5 lakh people suddenly become redundant. So how do you address that? The industry is significantly manpower driven and the nature and operations and socio-political environment governing the coal sector, the industry has still not adopted Industry 3.0 completely. And this sector has to invest significantly into reskilling. So it brings us again into the concept of reskilling. You've learned a trade, unlearn it, and then go and learn it. You know this typical Chinese proverb, you have a cup. You keep pouring water into it. After a certain point of time, what happens? The water starts overflowing. If you want a fresh water to come into it, you have to empty it. And same thing is about our skills. If we have to pick up new skills, we have to unlearn some of our older skills. Welding. The way welding was done 10 years down the back, and how welding is getting done now, and how welding will get done 10 years henceforth, is entirely different. You have a G1 to G6 positions. You ask a welder outside, he would not even know what you're talking about, a common welder. There are close to 135 kinds of welding. We mostly thought about 4, 5, 10. We lost out huge ship-breaking contracts and shipbuilding contracts because India does not have sufficient number of skilled workers. We talk about China. The cost of production, the labor wages, per hour labor rate in China is higher than India by close to $8 to $12 per hour. Still, bulk of manufacturing is happening in China. Why? Skill. So, like Tim Cook mentioned, he said, "I'm not getting Apple manufactured in China because of low cost. If I am looking at precision tooling in US, I go to a particular town, I'll be able to at-the-most fill an auditorium like this. I go to China, I can fill 4 football fields in every town on precision tooling." That's what people are paying for. And I'll share an example. In mining, there's an equipment called jumbo drill. It's a huge equipment. It's an underground mining equipment. It's got 2 to 4 drill booms attached to it. It's like a normal worker in India. You have an electrician or somebody. He's a professional worker. He'll carry a power drill with him, correct? For not only doing the drilling, but also working as a power tool for screwing, unscrewing, doing various activities. That's the kind of a job which a jumbo drill does in an underground mining scenario. It is used for development of the entire underground routes to reach the mine face. It is used for roof bolting on the surface, put the mesh wire and roof bolt so the roof doesn't collapse. It does everything. So it has become undisputably the king of underground mining equipment. It was introduced about 5-6 years back by a company in India. They trained Indian workers. The productivity was 25 to 30 drill bit meters per day. Same time, you had expats coming from Peru, Indonesia, Malaysia. They were drilling 125 to 150 meters per day, 5 to 6 times the productivity. So, and some of these workers, surprisingly, were Indians who were working in those companies there, and they're coming up back and demonstrating that kind of productivity. So we sat down with them to understand what's the difference. The difference was how you skill and train people. The training programs of the company that was running was a 3-month program, then attached to somebody, and then he starts learning. Here, we devised an 18-month training program, which incidentally is now getting into a 2-year training program, starting from basic classroom to lab to simulator to operating the equipment at the surface in the workshop areas and then progressively into the mine phase. And also working on the level 1 maintenance, which is a significant component of the uptime of the equipment. The first batch started in October 2018. They finished their training and joined their job in February 2016 they started, 18 they joined. The reports that started coming to us last year in August, September is, after 6 months of experience and working on the face, bulk of the kids are doing about 60 to 75 drill bit meters per day at against the Indian worker with 5-6 years of experience doing about 25 to 30. There are about 10 to 15 kids who are doing 150 to 130 to 135 drill bit meters per day. That's where the impact of the training starts coming in. These children, they came from, they're very simple, ITI diploma kids, no rocket scientists. But very structured training was delivered by the company. The cost of training, each candidate, direct cost is 6.5 lakh rupees per candidate. Indirect cost is 18 lakh rupees per candidate because you're sacrificing a mine face towards training and not using it for production. And when you're drilling, you have to blast it also because without that, the fresh face cannot be available. So that blasting is also going waste and the mucking is removal of the equipment. The blasted materials also is a non-productive activity. So indirectly, about close to 18 lakh rupees they were investing per kid and 6 lakh rupees directly. The production delivered by these kids is evident and shows the results. The expats, they were working at about 8 lakhs to 16 lakh rupees per month. The Indian kids, they started off at about 30 to 36 lakh rupees per month as a fixed wages. With overtime, production bonus, etc., it started creeping up. Last October, one of the kids shared his salary slip with us over the WhatsApp. Any idea what his salary would have been? Month of September salary. 36,000 basic, plus overtime, plus production bonus. 2,16,000 rupees. So mining is highly lucrative, but it's a very, very tough profession. When we start the training, Within first 15 days, we send the kids down. Out of every 100 kids that go down, about 10 to 15 come back and say, it's not our cup of tea. The noise, the vibration, high humidity, and the claustrophobic feeling is a very high deterrent. But then, there are skills that you need to pick up. So unavailability of talent for new age have made savvy organizations reskill their people ahead of demand at a price that makes sense for the organization. So they had workers who were working at 8 to 16 lakh rupees, and here you have workers who are working at 2 lakh rupees, 1/4 to 1/8 the cost. So it justifies the cost of training. But you have to believe in your training program first. Results will take time. You can't expect the results to start coming from next month itself. One such example is the work of communication giant AT&T. The company has invested in its workforce with its future-ready reskilling program costing $200 million to $250 million a year. To identify where every job function is headed and provide workers with training they need to prepare for the role that have a future. So when I go to a lot of conferences, you have people coming and say, you know, you have to be prepared for the job of tomorrow. Good. I'll prepare the kids. You tell me what is the job for tomorrow. It's an industry that has to work to identify which is the job for tomorrow. The skilling ecosystem will ensure we'll deliver to that. But you have to tell us what is your job for tomorrow. And that can only come by what you are planning. The planning department, the production planning department, and the HR has to work together to identify what I need in 2025. Because all high technology jobs take at least 1 year for development. So it will take about 6 months to a year to develop the curriculum, courseware, methodology, processes, because you'll have to bring in the global concepts into it, the best of the training methodologies into it. It'll take some time. 1 year for development of course, 1 year for delivering of the kid, and 1 year of on-the-job training before the trainee or the candidate is actually hands-on on it. There's a 3-year process. So unless you tell me what you require for tomorrow, I'll not be able to deliver it. So my submission to the industry is that please work closely and help identify what are the jobs of tomorrow. Such trends relating to reskilling initiatives was not heard of 10 years to 15 years back. But now the employers are trying to strengthen the skills and capabilities of their employees so that they can meet the changing business and organizational demands. While examples like this are limited as yet, we will see a lot of organizations picking up these trends. Skill development has moved beyond the government initiatives. If the industries have to survive and move into the next generation and not lose out to the competition, they will have to invest in skill development significantly. That brings me to the end of the call. Any questions, any queries?
What we'll do is that we'll have the questions later, let him also speak.
Thank you so much. Again, Dr. Garg, thank you very much for giving this opportunity.